right, quickly. Good morning. We're glad to have you in our service this morning. I know that the weather was not the best this morning for, getting up and getting out this morning, but I'm glad you chose to do so. And I know that you will be blessed just for doing that, so we're glad to see you here this morning. Let's get our announcements behind us. First of all, today is a very special day. This is called Sanctity of Life Sunday. We have observed that for many years. We originally had that as we did everything we could to do away with the Roe versus Wade decision. And fortunately, this past year, that was finally overturned. That just simply meant that court decision was no longer an obstacle for us. But that certainly didn't mean that the battle was over or that nothing else needed to be done. As a matter of fact, if you was paying attention in our last election cycle, we lost ground in that election cycle when we should have gained ground. And that's because I believe many folks inside of the church establishment and those of us that had been fighting for it thought that it was over with, and we just sat down and did not do some of the things we should have done as far as looking for good officials to run and then electing those that did run. And so there's much to be done, and so we need to continue to have that on the forefront, continue to realize that the number one thing we need to fight for is life, and nothing more precious than the life of a baby in its mother's womb. And so as a church, we stand up for that. And you do need to do more than just words. And of course, once we say that, we fight for that life, and then once that life is here, we need to guard it. We need to do things like adoption. We need to do things like have children in our homes that need a short period of time to find a safe place. Then there's many, many things that need to be done other than just talk about it in our church building. So a lot needs to be done, and we need to be involved in that. So we have Sanctity of Life Sunday, just to emphasize that. I don't have a sermon on that this morning, but it is a very important thing and one of those things we at our church and many churches around the country do emphasize, and we want that to be on the forefront of your mind. We think it is highly important, and we believe that is something the church should fight for. Then we want you to remember the things that we've got going on. Of course, this afternoon at 6 o'clock is our evening worship service. We will highlight some things that we don't get to highlight in the message this morning, and then we'll give you opportunity to ask questions about the message and things that we talk about. And then if you have any other questions on your mind, you can ask about that. And so we have a good time on Sunday afternoons. Folks ask a lot of good questions, and so you're invited to come. And ask a question. If it's on your mind, it's probably on somebody else's mind, and they sometimes are shy about asking questions. And we never make fun of somebody asking a question. Some of you I know very, very well, and I may pick at you just a little bit if I know you well enough to do that, but never make fun of anybody about asking a question. We enjoy questions, and you're welcome to come and ask those questions. So that's happening. And then on Tuesday night, those of you that have signed up for our constitutional life classes, we encourage you to continue to come. We're having a good time learning a lot about that. And so if you're signed up and coming, we encourage you to come for them. Wednesday night is our Wednesday night prayer meeting, classes all across the board. We're going to split one of our classes two Wednesday nights from now. Miss Debbie is going to take the fifth and sixth graders. Is that fifth and sixth graders? And Mandy's going to take the younger class under that, which I reckon third and fourth graders. There's too wide a distance in age there, and we've got enough students now to be able to do that. Miss Debbie's willing to help, and so we're going to split those classes so that we can teach them a little more effectively. So that'll be happening not this Wednesday night, but the following Wednesday night. So you can be looking forward to that on Wednesday nights as we do that. We are blessed, and we continue to have students come, and so we're looking forward to being able to do that. So please look forward to that. Remember, we do have a sign-up sheet already for our men's breakfast coming up the second Saturday in the month. We'd love to have you come and join with us. I think someone different is going to be cooking breakfast this coming, from what I heard, this coming time. So you come and join with us as we enjoy our men's get together at 7:30 in the morning. I think Tom wants to make an announcement, wants to make sure we got some things.
Yeah, we voted back in December as a church to provide background checks and to do background checks for anybody that is working kids, nursery to the youth. And it goes from if you're teaching kids, if you're chaperoning kids, if you're going to be in trips, if you're at Bible school, if you're anything to do with a kid, we're going to do a background check just for the safety of our kids and the church and all that. And if you haven't done it, I need to get it done before next Sunday. I got all the papers that go with it, and Kayla's got them too. So if you haven't done that, please see one of us, and let's get that handled. And if you already have, thank you for doing that.
This background check is not a background check trying to check your credit worthiness. We're not looking at what your credit is. We're looking at your history as far as it relates to children and what you've been involved in and those things. So don't be too anxious about that. Hopefully your background on credit's fine. But we're not worried about that. That's not what we're trying to do on it. And that is a limited amount of folks that are going to be looking at that, and then we'll have it stored in a very safe place that not everyone will be able to get a hold of. So we're trying to take precautions on all of that for you. Also, in announcements, we have two showers coming up for two of our ladies that are expecting, and so please know about both of those showers. You see them being flashed on the screens there in front of you, and I encourage you to participate in those, encourage those ladies as they look forward to these young ones coming into the world in the very near future. So those are coming up right ahead of us, so please prepare and plan for that. Any other information I need to give out as far as announcements? Yes, I'm sorry. And while the older ones don't have to have somebody specifically with them, they will be chaperoned. We will have an eye on them. We will be looking after them. We're not going to just turn them loose and say, hope you get back alive. So we will be looking after them. Yes?
Safety meeting.
Huh?
Safety meeting. After church this morning.
Okay.
Right up
here. Right. Yes, ma'am. Right. Yes, ma'am.
Recurring backpack ministry.
Okay. If you have food, that small breakfast type things on the table out front. Anybody behind me? All right. I got everybody. And then I have one that was asked to be put on the prayer list. Dave Vallis, is that how you say his name? He has the bull bar, is that how you say that? ALS, it is terminal, and has asked interest in our prayers. One of Ms. Donna's people that she works with. So if y'all would put Dave Vallis on your prayer list and be praying for him, that would be greatly appreciated for that. Oh, and one last, I'm sorry, okay, right here in front of me. We made mention of this last week. The Wild Horse Ministry is going to be down at Salem Baptist Church in Tifton, not the one we've got right down the street down here, but the one in Tifton, Salem Baptist Church. That's going to be on January the 29th at 3 p.m., and it is going to actually have a dinner afterwards. So Salem Baptist Church, January 29th, that's next Sunday at 3 p.m. We've had the Wild Horse Ministry here, wonderful ministry. And so you will have opportunity for that coming up. So that we want to make mention of that again so you have a knowledge of it. All right, I think we've got all that we need to do there. So it's time, Charlie, to lead us in a song.
I just don't believe in chance or luck or anything. I think things are done for a reason. God's in control of everything. But when I pick out the hymns during the week, and I struggle with that because I have my five favorite, and people tell me I sing my five favorite. That's at Calvary, Victory in Jesus, and, you know, the ones I sort of sing. So I try to sing some new stuff. I'll Fly Away. Okay. All right. See, they're behind me. All right. And when I wrote all this down, I didn't realize it. The first hymn is Are You Washed in the Blood? The one after the children is Nothing But the Blood. So maybe the theme is the blood. Now, Bruce, are you going to preach on the blood?
It'll be in there somewhere.
All right. If not, change your message before we... All right. Just go on and change your sermon right now. But I didn't realize that until I wrote this down. I thought, why in the world are I going this way? But, you know, God's in control. So, all right. 330, Are You Washed in the Blood? Let's all stand.
Chapter 33. Read the first 26 verses. Jeremiah chapter 33. Still here, page of two turning. I think most of us have found it by now. It says, Moreover, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah a second time while he was still shut up in the court of the prison, saying, Thus says the Lord who made it, the Lord who formed it to establish it, the Lord is his name. Call to me, and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things which you do not know. For thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the houses of this city and the houses of the kings of Judah, which have been pulled down to fortify against the siege mounds and the sword, They come to fight with the Chaldeans, but only to fill their places with the dead bodies of men whom I will slay in my anger and my fury, all for those whose wickedness I have hidden my face from this city. Behold, I will bring it health and healing. I will heal them and reveal to them the abundance of peace and truth. And I will cause the captives of Judah and the captives of Israel to return and will rebuild those places as at first. I will cleanse them from all their iniquity by which they have sinned against me, and I will pardon all their iniquities by which they have sinned and by which they have transgressed against me. Then it shall be to me a name of joy, a praise, and an honor before all nations of the earth who shall hear all the good that I do to them. They shall fear and tremble for all the goodness and the prosperity that I will provide for it. Thus says the Lord, again, there shall be heard in this place of which you say, it is desolate, without man and without beast, in the cities of Judah, in the streets of Jerusalem that are desolate, without man and without inhabitant and without beast, the voice of joy and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, the voice of those who will say, praise the Lord of hosts, for the Lord is good, for his mercy endures forever. And of those who will bring the sacrifice of praise unto the house of the Lord, for I will cause the captives of the Lord to return as at the first, says the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, in this place which is desolate, without man and without beast, and in all its cities, there shall be again be a dwelling place of shepherds causing their flocks to lie down. In the cities of the mountains, in the cities of the lowland, and in the cities of the south, in the land of Benjamin, in the places around Jerusalem, in the cities of Judah, in the flocks shall again pass under the hand of him who counts them, says the Lord. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will perform that good thing which I have performed, which I have prophesied to the house of Israel and to the house of Judah. In those days, and at that time, I will cause to grow up to David a branch of righteousness. He shall execute judgment and righteousness in the earth. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will dwell safely. And this is the name by which she shall be called, the Lord our righteousness. For thus says the Lord, David shall never lack a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel, nor shall the priests, the Levites, lack a man to offer burnt offerings before me, to kindle grain offerings, and to sacrifice continually. And the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, thus says the Lord, if God can break my covenant with the day and my covenant with the night, so that there will not be day and night in the next season, then my covenant also may also be broken with David my servant, so that he shall not have a son to reign on his throne with the Levites, the priests, my ministers. As the host of heaven cannot be numbered, nor the sand of the sea measured, so will I multiply the descendants of David my servants and the Levites who minister to me. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, how far was I going to read in this? 26, thank you. Have you not considered what these people have spoken, saying, the two families which the Lord has chosen, he has also cast them off. Thus they have despised my people as if they should no more be a nation before me. Thus says the Lord, if my covenant is not with day and night, and if I have not appointed the ordinance of heaven and earth, then I will cast away the descendants of Jacob and David, my servant, so that I will not take any of his descendants to be rulers over the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For I will cause our captives to return and will have mercy on them. All right, Tim, will you lead us in prayer?
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come to your house and hear your word read to us. I pray, Lord, that we can take your word and apply it to our lives. And Lord, as the scripture says, that we will not sin against thee. And Lord, we pray for ones on our prayer list, God, to reach down and touch and heal. We thank you, Lord, for ones that are doing better. Where death is entered in, Lord, I pray that you fill that vacancy with your love. Just wrap your arms around the families, the ones that are caring for them, Lord, just have your way in their lives. And Lord, I pray for our church services this morning, Lord. Bless Brother Bruce who brings the message, Lord. Just let everything we do here glorify you. I pray, Lord, for our military, our leaders of our country, our nation, and our state and local governments, Lord, that you continue to lead them and with the wisdom they need to make the right decisions so that we can draw this country back to you. And again, Lord, I ask you just to bless us today. Give us a good day in your house where we can leave the day and say it was good to be in the house of the Lord. Now watch over and care for each one of us, Lord. Forgive us if we fail, then and draw us all near to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's fun to be at church. It's fun. Good morning. How are y'all today on this rainy day? We'll start off today reading out of the Bible. We're going to read out of Matthew chapter 7. And I'm going to read verse 24, and then I'm going to read verse 26. I'm going to skip one in there, okay? All right, this is what it says. This is Jesus talking, by the way. Jesus says this, "Whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man which built his house upon a rock." And then we're going to skip down a verse, and it says, "Everyone that hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand." There's two things that jump out at me right there. That Jesus likened somebody to a wise man, and he likened others to the foolish man. He says, whoever hears these sayings of mine, he's talking about these sayings in the Bible, whoever hears these sayings and does them, acts on them, is a wise man. But whoever hears these sayings and does not do them is a foolish man. It made me think about, what's the difference between a smart man and a wise man? You ever thought about that? You hear the term smart all the time. You hear the term wise. But are they the same thing? Are they the same thing? I don't think so. I'm going to tell you what I think. Back in the day, back in Jesus' day, I have read and been told that a lot of the Jewish people had memorized the Bible. Did you know that? Or at least the Old Testament. The New Testament wasn't there yet in Jesus' day. It was being written, right? But they memorized the Old Testament. They could tell you the Old Testament from beginning to end, every word from memory. That's pretty smart, don't you say? That's pretty smart. Can you imagine memorizing the entire Bible? I have a hard time just remembering some of the verses. I memorize some verses, but I don't know, 2 months later, if you were to ask me to repeat it to you, I'd get probably 75% of it right. I'd leave out a word here, maybe a word there. It's hard to memorize verses, isn't it? I would say those Jewish folks were pretty smart. Don't you think? It takes a smart person to be able to memorize all of that. Look at the words. Look at all that. Well, they spent their entire lives doing it. They started at your age and even younger, and they went to school, and at school they would start with Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and they'd memorize it, and then they'd move to verse 2, and then verse 3. And then by the time they were 30, 40 years old, they had the whole thing memorized. But still, that's pretty smart. If you were to memorize this entire Bible, I think you could easily say that's a smart person. What Jesus is saying here, though, is if you memorize the entire Bible and you're a smart guy or a smart gal, but then you don't take what you've learned and apply it to life, that smartness is doing you no good because you lack wisdom. You lack wisdom. See, that's the difference according to Jesus. According to the Bible, the difference is smartness will help you remember this stuff, but if you don't do anything with it, you're foolish. If you go out and you apply it to your life. You know, the Bible says, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. It takes a smart person to know that. It takes a really wise person to apply it to their life. And Jesus is saying here, if you know that verse and you don't use it in your life and you don't do it, he's likening us to a foolish man if we live that way. So, there's the difference between a wise man and a smart man, and a foolish man, by the way. As you live your life and you go through Sunday school classes and you come and you sit in church and you hear this book read to you and preached to you and you go home and you read it yourself, remember this. As you learn it, as you memorize certain things, as the Lord imprints certain things on your heart, make sure that you apply it in life. You use these things and be a wise person, okay? Let's say a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this day. Lord, there has been some smart people walk this planet, Lord. There's a lot of smart people in this room, much smarter than me. They can memorize so much of this Bible, Lord. They know so much about it. And Lord, you tell us, Lord, that as we learn these things, that you're not so much worried about just how smart we are, just how much of it we can memorize and maybe repeat from heart, Lord, but you're worried about us learning it and then using it. You're worried about the wisdom that we display, Lord, that we're wise enough to learn these things and then show them in our life to show you that we love you. Lord, help us to not be foolish. Help us to not use these things in life. Help us to be like the wise man who built his house upon a rock and learn your word and use it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Off to a hymn, Nothing But the Blood. Let's all stand. In prayer.
two things right quick I'd like to tell you before I get started. First, we will have someone at the back door taking our Lottie Moon offering up this morning. So if you came prepared and wanted to give to that, there'll be someone there. And then this month has five Sundays in it. So if you haven't noticed, next Sunday will be in the month of January. And that means fifth Sunday night, we will have Isabella Baptist Church coming up, joining with us on fifth Sunday night, and we'll have worship service together with them. And we've had the pleasure of having Thomas Hammond come and speaking to us on fifth Sunday night. So Thomas Hammond is our director of Georgia Baptist Mission Board. He is director of Georgia Baptist Churches. And so it's his place to try to help all of Georgia Baptist Churches accomplish what we try to accomplish. So he's got a pretty good job. It's worse than herding cats, I imagine. So we are thrilled that he would be willing to come and speak on that Sunday night. And so we would encourage you to come and join with us, and he will preach. And then he is going to give a short idea of what's going on with all the churches in the state of Georgia, our Southern Baptist churches, and then he's going to open it up and let us ask questions, so that if you have any questions about what's going on in the state of Georgia. And one of the reasons that's important is when you give money to our church, we give a portion of that money through our local association. It goes to the Georgia Baptist to help with all the things that go on in the state of Georgia, and then eventually through Southern Baptist throughout the world. And so it's very important, it should be, to where your money goes. So you'll have that opportunity next Sunday night as Thomas comes and talks with us and preaches. All right, take your Bibles and turn to the book of Revelation. If you're going to look in your Bible, and I encourage you to do that. If not, we'll have it on the screens, and we're going to read the 20th chapter. For you that are able and can stand, we ask you to stand in honor of the Word of God. John continues and says, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil, and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. Then I saw the souls of them who had been beheaded for their witness to Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations which are in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them together to battle, whose number is as the sand of the sea. They went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." I'll turn the page at some point here. There you go. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged each according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Thank you. You can be seated. I'm not leaving. Robbie is. I have no hope or hardly even desire to cover the entire 20th chapter. That would be way too much. Plus, Debbie has threatened me with my life if I don't get done within a reasonable time. She's got the little kids back there this morning taking care of them. And so I have to finish within a reasonable period of time this morning. But we'll cover what we can reasonably do this morning. Let me see if I can get us all up to date, because not all of us have been here for the period of time that we're doing. So here in the 20th chapter, we're coming to the end of things. Jesus has come. The end of the tribulation has been. The devil has caused the beast and the false prophet to gather the nations of the world together in the Battle of Armageddon. Jesus has come. The world has turned against him. He has devoured them as he has come from heaven on the white horse with the armies of heaven behind them. The armies of heaven have included us, the church, the angels, and those that are in heaven. And now he is beginning to make ready for the presentation of the marriage of the Lamb. For the past 7 years, the church, the bride of Christ, has been in heaven receiving her rewards at the marriage supper of the Lamb, which will be finished, completed in the 21st chapter when we get there in a little bit. And so now the things are being prepared for that. The beast and the false prophet has been dealt with. They have been cast into the lake of fire. We looked at that briefly last week. The lake of fire is that permanent, final place of punishment for everyone that is opposed to the will of God. The beast and the false prophets are the first beings cast there. During the period of time which we're living in now, people reside in a temporary place of punishment that we call hell. Eventually, that place will be folded into the lake of fire, and they will be there forever. And so now we're coming at that period of time. We call this the second coming of Jesus. Some folks misunderstand or misapply or miscall the rapture of the church, the second coming of Jesus. That is a foretaste, that is a beginning, but it is not literally the second coming of Jesus. That is the coming of Jesus for his bride, for the church, and it begins the tribulation period, that 7 years of time that the Lord is bringing out Israel and preparing them for the millennial kingdom, which we'll discuss a little bit this morning, and preparing for the time of the marriage of the Lamb and all the things that we'll talk about. And so we're at that point now. We've come up to that in the 20th chapter. There's one final thing that has to be dealt with, of course, and that is Satan himself. And, of course, we're hoping, we look and say, well, finally we're going to get rid of this monster. We're going to get rid of the devil. But we find out here that that's not quite the case yet. Opens up, and the Lord sends an angel. Doesn't tell us who this angel is. He just sends an angel. And doesn't tell us it's an archangel. Doesn't tell us it's any particular angel. Just tells us he sends an angel. And that angel takes the devil, and he binds him in a pit, in the abyss, in a cell for 1,000 years. He's not yet in the lake of fire. That's a permanent place. Once you go to the lake of fire, you don't come back out of it. There's no other place to go. You're permanently in the lake of fire when you're there. And so so he's sealed for 1,000 years in this place that's called the pit or the abyss that he's put in, and he's sealed there, and he can't get out. So he has 1,000 years to think about who he is and what he's done and what his position is there for that. And so while that goes on, the Bible tells us then, while the devil is there for that period of time, he says, then here on planet Earth, without the opposition of the devil, without the insinuation of the devil, without all the problems, we see a little tidbit that's thrown in there. It says, one of the main energies of the devil is that he has been agitating the nations. He has been the one behind nations that causes the problems of the nations. It says here in that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years. So he has been doing his greatest work as he comes into nations, and as they are doing what God has called them to do, to be the governments of the earth, to cause peace and tranquility on the earth. That's what God has set governments up for. Well, the devil comes along and disturbs and troubles nations and deceives nations, which he's doing to our nation right now. And that's what he does, and that's what we are as in the United States. We the people, we are the government. That's what we are to cause not to happen. I'm not preaching on that this morning, but I want you to know that's there. That's what the devil's main tool is. Now, his minions, demons, are out and about, and they are disturbing and causing all kind of problems among individuals. The devil is just one wicked angel. He can only be in one place at a time, so he spends his energy and time among governments, among nations. And so he won't be able to do that during that period of time, so there will be relatively tranquility on earth, because the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, will reign during this 1,000-year period of time. As an aside there, isn't it marvelous, I believe would be the word to say, that he picks the 1,000 years. He could have picked any period of time. It wouldn't matter. But he picks the millennium, 1,000 years. In the early period of time, man lived, the longest man lived, was almost 1,000 years. Methuselah lived 969 years. And I know a lot of folks say, well, is that real years? Well, the answer to that question is yes. A year is a year. In the Bible never deviates. It always, when it tells time, it tells real time. And it never says, if a day is a day, a day is from sundown evening to sundown the next evening. That's a day in the Bible. That's how the day talks about time. And it's always the real sun and the real sun going down and the real sun coming up and the real moon. So it's literal. The Bible is literal. And so when it talks about a literal day, it's a literal day. When it talks about a literal week, it's a literal week, unless it gives you indication it's talking about something else. Sometimes it will talk about a prophetic week, and it tells you about those things. It always lets you know what it's talking about. And so when it tells you nothing else, and it just says the 1,000 years, it means 1,000 years. When it talks about a year, if it doesn't tell you anything else, it's talking about a year. So when it says Methuselah lived for 969 years, guess how long Methuselah lived? 969 years. I don't care what anybody else says, and I don't care what those smart folks that don't have any wisdom say. That's how long he lived. And so it's just, to me, it's interesting that God chose then to let this period of time be 1,000 years. Some of y'all might say, well, it don't mean anything to me. Might not you, but it does to me, okay? So, and I'm the one preaching right now. So when you preach, it means something to you. So he set it up for 1,000 years. And so we begin what we call the millennial kingdom. So this is one of those passages. I don't want to lose you. So easy to lose folks here, because see what happens when we come to the revelation, the Bible makes some assumptions about you folks. And that's always good assumptions about some of us. The Bible assumes, the writer, which is John here through the Holy Spirit, that when you read the last chapter, you know what happened in the rest of the Bible. And it assumes that you have a good working knowledge of what takes place. Without a good working knowledge of what has taken place before Revelation, you're not going to understand what's going on here. And to just pick the book up and just start reading it and to believe that you're going to understand what's there is not a wise thing to do. And so then when you start reading things here, it tells you stuff with the assumption that you know the correlating and surrounding information you should know. And what I have to do then when I start teaching and preaching to you, I have to fill that material in for you. And I don't want to lose you when I do that. So I will try my best not to do that this morning, okay? And I'm not going to do too awful much of it, so don't go to sleep yet, all right? I just want to give you just the basics, then you can go back and study. Because, see, he just mentioned something here that you need to know what happened. He mentioned, this is the first resurrection. And he mentions here only about the resurrection of those folks that were martyred during the tribulation period. Well, the Bible assumes that you know that that's not all that got resurrected here. There was much more happening. You should know about it. But the Bible doesn't take the time up here to tell you about it because that's talked about in other places in the Bible. And you're to understand that when you read this. Unfortunately, a lot of folks don't understand that, and so they make all kind of wild claims here and distort Scripture and mess the plain view of the Bible up. So let me just briefly tell you what has happened here. The Lord has come back from heaven and on the white horse that we've talked about, and as he does so and conquers there, the first resurrection takes place. In that resurrection, what is stated here, the resurrection of those martyred in the tribulation period takes place, along with the resurrection of all the saints of the Old Testament. All of those that died in the time of David, all of those that died in the time of Abraham, all of those that died in the time of Isaiah, all of those that died in the time of Daniel, all of those that died in the Old Testament that were saved by faith, looking forward to the coming of the Messiah, that they had placed their hope in that, those that had been redeemed the same as anybody else through the blood of Jesus Christ, looking forward to the cross, those folks are redeemed and are resurrected as Christ comes, just like he told Mary and Martha when he raised Lazarus from the dead, just like he told through the Apostle Paul in the 15th chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians at the first resurrection. The coming for the church is a unique thing. The coming of the church was a mystery hidden in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures. But the coming of the first resurrection is not hidden in the Old Testament. It is plainly talked about. It is plainly prophesied and can plainly be seen. And that's what takes place. And you should know when it says Jesus comes back that this is what is being talked about. So all that are godly, have died godly and righteously in Christ, has looked forward to the Messiah, all of those are resurrected at the first resurrection when Christ comes back here at the end of the tribulation period. All of those are resurrected and stand before Christ, are given a resurrection body. Now, you don't see that here. He doesn't tell you that because you ought to know it. It has plainly been prophesied and plainly been talked about, and so you ought to know those things. So that's there. So I lose you if I'm not careful here because, you know, well, where's that at? Show it to me. Well, I can go back to all kind of Scripture, and tonight, if you want me to, we'll go through some of those. But for this morning, just so I don't lose, because I'll lose a bunch of you if I go to doing that. And I just want you to know that it's here for you students to know. So we have the first resurrection. Now, having a first resurrection assumes what? A second resurrection. Right? Okay. And so he tells us a first and second resurrection are set apart by 1,000 years. The second resurrection is for all of those who have rejected Christ. People that do not know Jesus as Savior, those in the Old Testament, see, they're not resurrected because they don't know Jesus when Jesus comes back. They stay in the grave. Only those that know have looked forward to the coming of the Messiah. All the unredeemed stay in their graves, and they are raised at the end of the millennial kingdom, and then they come, and we'll talk about that next week, what happens to them. And so that'll get us to verse 4. So that's what happens. So he says, "And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed to them." Who sits on the thrones? Well, Jesus decides who sits on the thrones. I know he tells the disciples that they would sit on the thrones. He didn't say all these thrones. They will. I think some of the Old Testament saints, I think David will sit on a throne. Some of the Old Testament saints, I think for certain, he tells those martyred in the tribulation period, they will sit on thrones. He says, we will be made kings and priests unto God. So some New Testament saints will sit on thrones. We will rule and reign with him, he says. So he will designate those that have served him righteously and have earned that place to sit on a throne, thrones with him, and reign with him during the millennial kingdom, will sit on thrones. Some who have not lived a life to deserve to sit on thrones will not. They will serve in different places during the millennial kingdom, but they will not have earned the right to sit on the thrones with him. And so different ones will do so during that thousand-year rule and reign with Christ during that period of time. So there will be a thousand-year period. I want to answer really four questions quickly. I've got about 10 minutes or so before Debbie starts screaming at me. So I want to answer four questions real quickly for us now. First, I want to answer the three that says, why a millennial kingdom at all? Why? There are those that say, I don't even believe there will be a millennial kingdom. There's a great group of folks that doesn't even believe. Augustine, which is one of the early church fathers, he lived in the 5th century. We credit him with a lot of our church doctrine and theology, a great thinker. He did not believe that there would be a millennial kingdom. If you've ever done any study of the church, one of his books, The City of God, tremendous book. We get a lot of teaching from Augustine, but he was an amillennialist. Ah in the Greek, the A, it means no, like an atheist, and it means no millennium. And so he did not believe that, and so a lot of folks have picked up because of all of his great teaching, the no millennium, and there's a lot of folks believe they will not be a millennium at all. And there are some post-millennialists that believe that believe Jesus will return at the end of the millennial kingdom, and so they believe that there will not be a coming of Christ until after the millennial kingdom. They believe that the church is going to make the world better and better and better and better, and eventually when the church makes the world good enough, Jesus will come back. There's not a whole lot of those folks around right now. The world's not getting that good. And then there's premillennialists, which I am, that believes Jesus will come back before the millennial kingdom, and there's a whole bunch of folks that have all kinds of different ideas in premillennialism. So three reasons I believe that there must be a millennial kingdom. Number one is that God promised Abraham a kingdom. God promised Abraham. He said in the 12th chapter of the book of Genesis, "I will make of thee a great nation." He took Abraham out. And he said, "Look up at the sky. Say, see all those stars? I'm going to give you descendants more than those stars." He says, "Look out there at the sand on the desert. See all that sand? I'm going to give you descendants more than all that sand." So I'm making you promises. I'm making you promises, Abraham, that are unconditional. I'm not making these promises based on how good you are. I'm not telling you about how you keep yourself. I'm not telling you how you live. I'm not telling you whether you sin or not. Abraham was a pretty good sinner. I'm not telling you all of those things. I'm saying based on what my word is, I am God Almighty, and I decree because of who I am giving you these promises. And based on that, he promised Abraham that his descendants would inherit the earth and this kingdom. Based on these promises, God must set up a kingdom for Abraham. Number two, we read about it in Jeremiah chapter 33 and it's also in 2 Samuel chapter 7. God promised David a throne, a kingdom forever, King David. God promised him that there would be a descendant to sit upon the throne of David forever. And again, God promised this as an unconditional promise, not based upon David, not based upon how David's descendants would act, but based upon the everlasting promises of God. As a matter of fact, as we read in the book of Jeremiah, he said, as long as there was day and night, as long as the sun hung in the sky, as long as the moon was up there, and the last time I noticed, the moon was still up there and the sun was still up there, as long as those things happened, God says that he would fulfill his promise, those things being certain and sure, I believe that God is going to keep his promise and that there will be one of the lineage of David sitting on that throne. Of course, Christ is the greater David, and he will sit on that throne to fulfill that promise. Number three, I believe it is so that man can truly know what the heart of man is. The millennial kingdom will be so that the heart of man can be exposed. After having lived for 1,000 years under the righteous rule of Christ without the devil being there, without the hindrances of the kingdom of evil, man's heart will still be exposed to be in rebellion against God. Given the opportunity with a perfect government, see, today folks say, but listen, if I just had a perfect environment, that's what many folks are trying to say. If I could just have, you know, everything made right for me, if I didn't have all these problems, then I'd be okay. I could live right. No, you can't. You've got a problem. It's an inside job. You were born in iniquity. I was born in iniquity. I have sin in me. It's a disease. It's a cancer. And so man's heart will be exposed. And it will be shown that the only answer for man's problem is Jesus. His only hope will have been to surrender to the Lord Jesus Christ. And then finally, a fourth one, and I think one that's sometimes unseen here, and I think needs to be seen, is the devil himself will see that he indeed is a wicked, unredeemable character. He will have 1,000 years to think about his circumstance. He will be in that locked up cell for 1,000 years. He will have 1,000 years to consider what could be done. Now, I don't believe there's any hope, any mercy for the devil. But at the end of 1,000 years, if there was any glimmer, any possibility, if there was any truth, anything in him that was possibly a ray of hope, it should have had the opportunity to have been thought about and come out in that period of time. And it is evident after 1,000 years, there is nothing of any value. No hope. There's only evil in the heart of the devil. Nobody, the devil himself cannot say God did not at least give him a chance to think about it. Even the devil had 1,000 years to ruminate on it. Even the devil had 1,000 years to sit there and wonder. He didn't know how long he was going to be there. I mean, he can read these scriptures, but remember, the devil is blinded. Sin has blinded him. He had 1,000 years, and the minute he got turned loose, he was like a mad, roaring bull. He couldn't wait to get out and get his one more chance. Some folks cast God as a mean ogre. They just see God as bad. Say, well, God, why does God do? Oh, I see the mercy of God. I see the loving kindness of God. Look how good God is. Here for 1,000 years, he takes humanity and he just loves on them. He takes his church. He takes the saints of old He rules and reigns in righteousness. The Bible says, with a rod of iron. If someone does evil, he puts that evil down. Instant righteousness. He rules. He causes all to be able to see what right living is like. Nobody gets away with evil. If somebody does evil, automatically things are taken care of. Nobody gets by with it. All is done well for 1,000 years. If man ever had a chance, what a chance. That's loving kindness. If you ever had God's arms put around you and loved on you for 1,000 years, and still man's heart is evil. And the devil. Something never deserved anything, the devil never did, but for 1,000 years he got to think about it. But God's loving kindness still existed. What a God. I want to tell you, if there was nothing else to draw me to God, that draw me. God is a loving, kind, merciful God. He's a good God. I want to tell you, that's the God I call you to. That's the God I say, serve Him. Don't serve this old world. It doesn't care about you. It'll use you up and spit you out and then walk over you and don't care anything about you. But I will tell you, this book is about a good, kind, sweet God. Now listen, He's holy. You push Him. And we'll have to talk about another side of Him next week. But you don't have to deal with that side. Jesus has already dealt with that side of Him. All you have to do is turn your life over to Him. And He's a sweet, kind, merciful God. What a good God He is. Why not let Him love on you today? Father, speak to our hearts. Thank You for being such a good, good God. You've already told us in Your book, You did not desire any of us to die and go to hell. You loved every one of us so much that You sent Your one and only Son here. And You allowed Him to die for us that we might live with You forever. Help us to see Your goodness and Your kindness this morning. Draw us to Yourself, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.